Welcome, everybody, and thanks once again for joining us here at the Project GenX Podcast. I am one of your hosts, Alan Smith. It is just me this time. I am putting together a year-end retrospective of what we did in 2020, and I hope that you guys... I hope you have made it this far, as well as all your loved ones. I know it's been a rough year, but we here at the Project GenX Podcast, we've been trying to keep you entertained all year long. And so now we're going to take a look back at what we did, you know, some of the episodes and some of the just completely off the rail stuff that happened over the course of 12 months. So we hope you enjoy, and we're going to get started with this first clip.
And we have a special guest today, Big Dave. Introduce.
Today we've got with us my wife, the fabulous Miss Nay, and she's a self-proclaimed bigger Star Wars geek than I am.
This is our 50th episode, and we decided we were going to do something special and do Star Wars.
Yeah.
Also, something special that we're going to do from now on is that we are no longer calling, for this episode, we are not calling Dave Big Dave. He is Mr. Nay.
So oh, it's. Oh, no. Oh, no.
I love it.
Because we all know who wears the pants in the family. So yep.
All right. Thank you, Alan.
It's been fun being on the podcast. I guess you and my wife will be having more fun than I will from now on.
Yeah, well, you know.
Yes, that was... that was the infamous Mr. Nay clip from our 50th episode, and we want to thank Ms. Nay for coming on and sharing that very special episode with us. You know, talking about Star Wars being such a, you know, that being such a huge marker in Gen X as far as pop culture goes. And she brought a lot of insight, and who knows, we might have her back this next year to talk about something else and to, you know, bust Dave's balls a little more. So this next clip we're going to do, well, let's just say that it is, it's more of the same when it comes to busting Dave's balls.
Oh, yeah.
I can't believe I'm going to actually admit this.
Okay.
In one of the American Pie movies, the mm-hmm. one where Stifler has to do the dance-off.
American Wedding, yeah.
You know the black and green tribal shirt that he's wearing?
You had one?
I had one. I had that exact stinking shirt.
I know.
I had the exact shirt, and when it showed up on the movie, I sank down in my seat mm-hmm. so low. Mm-hmm. I was like, oh, I cannot believe I'm Stifler.
Yes, Dave admitted to having an early 2000s rave shirt, similar to the one that Stifler was wearing in American Wedding. Believe me, there are enough embarrassing moments to go around for all of us, but since I'm doing this, only his are going to be aired on here. So, love you, Dave. Anyway, our very first episode of the year was about odd jobs, about you know, jobs that we'd had over the years. And we started off talking about 2020 and how we kind of thought things might go. And it's very interesting to listen to now. So here you go.
So we'll be...
Welcome to the 20s.
I know, we'll be in 2020. And who thought? You know, that's something... I have said this so many times in the last year, especially. You know, Dave and I are both born in the mid-70s.
Early mid-70s.
We were in the early mid-70s, yeah. And when we were growing up, all of Gen X, when we were growing up, okay,
yeah,
there was that question of, what's the year 2000 going to be like? You know, what's going to happen in the year 2000?
I wanted my flying car.
Yeah, exactly.
I've been watching the Jetsons.
Exactly. You know, and there was also that, you know, I remember in grade school, us sitting and being like, how old are you going to be in the year 2000? You know, blah, 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 you know, type stuff. And and I was 25, turned 26 shortly thereafter. So, you know, it's like, all right, you know, that's where we are. That was 20 years ago.
See, when I think 20 years ago, I'm still thinking like the 80s.
Yeah, see, it's not, though. Yeah. So the 80s are almost 40 years ago. It's going to be, well, actually, as this is released, 1980 will be 40 years ago.
Yeah.
And I honestly, it doesn't bother me a whole lot.
I'm not going to lie, that hurts a little bit.
Yeah, where we are.
We're going back to the 20s, mm-hmm. I kind of hope they bring back, you know, old fashioned stuff comes back around eventually. I want to see the flapper dresses come back. I do.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, we're going to go back 100 years rather than 20.
You know, if we're going to do this, let's do it the right way and bring back, you know, the gilded times.
That was like I said, in that first episode, we talked about jobs that we had had earlier in our lives. And here is kind of a supercut of a couple of stories out of our our work history. And I think you're going to enjoy these because I really enjoyed going back and hearing them again.
I'm just like, all right. Anyway, I worked in the mall for a short amount of time at a retail establishment. I'll say it. I worked at Hot Topic
for a few months.
And that only, a few months.
It was out here in Hickory Hollow, wasn't it?
Well, I started off there. It was when they opened, they were opening the store over here at Rivergate.
Okay.
And so that was, it's funny because that's almost 20 years ago. Like that place opened in April of 2000.
That's where I got all my bowling shirts from.
Yeah, that's at the time when they were, that was the big thing, you know. It was funny because when Hot Topic first broke nationally, it was really a goth store.
Yeah, that's exactly what it was.
And then at that time, they had moved into the pop punk whatever, you know. Yeah. And so you had a lot of bowling shirts and, you know.
Well, they weren't just bowling shirts. They were Vegas style bowling shirts.
And not just the bowling shirts, but like the work shirts, you know.
And, and then all of a sudden, the guy who hired me packed up and went back to Atlanta.
Okay.
And I forget what the reason was, but I think it was family or something. And then that manager left and they hired a new manager.
Mm-hmm. And that's when it all started going to hell, didn't it?
that manager wasn't much older than me and was lazy. He would just go back and sit in the office and leave everything up to me and Mr. Mack. That guy got fired, and they brought in a new manager. And he was different.
Okay.
And then one day I came in and somebody goes, and he was driving the company van, the delivery van for his personal vehicle. Like he would drive it home and then drive it back to work. And then if I, you know, when he got ready to go home, be it at like 1 or 2 o'clock, you know, he'd drive the company van home and then I couldn't make deliveries, after a certain amount of time. This is the kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And of course I've had to train both of them on what the job. I'm already handling all the paperwork.
Right.
I'm handling, you know.
And that's always fun when you have to like hire, you have to train your boss. Your future boss.
I'm already doing accounts payable. I'm doing accounts receivable. I'm actually handling the payroll and calling it into the district office, you know, for all the payroll stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm handling all the, and then all of a sudden one of the contractors comes in and goes, hey, I saw your van up at the police department.
Okay.
At the police department. He goes, yeah, it was parked out front.
Okay.
It's like, okay. So I call up the police department. I go, this is so-and-so with Benjamin Moore. And somebody said they saw our delivery van up there. Is there something going on? He goes, you should probably come up here and collect it.
Oh, no.
I was like,
oh, no.
Oh. So I go up to the police, and they're like, you know, here's, you know, he has been arrested.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to get into why he was arrested.
Right, he's arrested, okay.
So I collect the van. I go, well, he also had a company phone that was on him.
Mm-hmm.
We need that back. And they're like, well, you'll have to go up to the Sumner County Sheriff's Department to collect all that because all of his belongings were on him when he got transferred.
Right.
Great. So I go back to the store. I tell Mr. Mack what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
And I call a locksmith to start the process of changing the locks on all the doors of the building. And I drive up to the sheriff's department, identify myself. I work here. He has property that belongs to the building. I need that back.
Right.
And get the company phone and the keys and, you know, all that.
Right.
And I go back to the store just in time for the locksmith to be finishing up changing the locks. And I pay him out of petty cash from the till and go back to the office to call my district manager, and the phone rings and it's the district manager.
All right.
In a panic.
Okay.
Hey, you know, Mr. Mack told me that somebody from one of the news channels had called.
Oh no.
And I knew that he was also on the board for Hendersonville City Parks.
Oh, man.
And so when they called again, I was like, No, I can't comment.
Yeah, no
on,
comments whatsoever.
I can't comment on his status with the company, but I can tell you that he was also on the board at Hendersonville City Parks. Would you like to talk to them? You might. Here's their phone number. Oh, wow. And they immediately hung up on me and forgot about us. Mm-hmm. You know, I feel bad for Hendersonville City Parks because I sicked them. I sicked the news media on them to divert.
Right, right.
And then the district manager called. It's like, hey, I need you to do this. I was like, done. This mm-hmm. is done. This is done. This already is done. I've already fired him. He's gone. Mm-hmm. And he was like, wow, I guess we need to find you a new manager.
After everything you've done.
So after everything I've done and handled the press for you, you're not going to offer me the position
to find a new manager. Yeah.
Yeah. And then like 3 months later, they made me responsible for actually closing up the store and shutting it down.
I worked for a movie gallery for
a year. Oh, the video store.
Oh, my goodness. Where to even begin with this
one? The creeper back room.
Well, yeah, we had an adult room. I have some great, great stories working in that place that deal with that adult room that I probably cannot tell on this.
You can't tell. Every stereotype exactly right.
There's nothing like dirty about the stories or anything. It's just the people dealing.
Oh, yeah.
That you had to deal with that, you know, was like, oh, great, here we go, you know, type stuff. And working in video rental, people are always trying to get out of late fees way or another. As if you remember going to video stores, they would usually have some kind of promotion of, they would have like a gumball machine up front or something, you know, and like some of the gumballs would have like
clear plastic,
like tin foil on them or something, you know, and like if you got one of those, then you get a free movie rental, you know, and it's kind of, you know, those giveaways. So we had that. We had that gumball, you know, with the, and I would refill it from time to time, you know, and we would select ones. Okay, we're going to put the tin foil on this and throw it in, you know, and when people get it, you're just like, okay, well, bring it to me and I'll give you a voucher for, you know, don't just walk around the tin foil because you could have brought that from anywhere. You know, bring it to me, I'll give you a voucher for, you know, whatever. Usually they would use it that day more than anything. Yeah. You know, you very rarely would see somebody like, oh, can I just, you know, use this later? You know, we even got to the point where we just put it on their account where it's like, hey, they get a free rental, you know, at some point. So in doing that, if you got one of those, whenever you redeemed it, you had to sign the receipt. Like they would print two receipts and you would have to sign saying that you, and then we would staple that, you know, the voucher or the tinfoil or whatever it was to that. And then we kept all that because this was pre everything digital age. And so, you know, we actually had paperwork and we had this room back off to the side of the store that had like boxes and boxes of this paperwork. And they would say like, August 1997 or, you know, whatever on the side. And that's where all that paperwork went into.
Which you had to keep for 7 years.
Yeah, exactly. For IRS issue purposes. So one night I'm working and I was the only one there. And then it was a Friday night. Yeah. Friday nights starting about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, 4:30, 5 o'clock. We'd get nuts because people were coming in and, you know, they're going to get something to watch for the weekend.
Yeah.
And Friday nights more than Saturday. I mean, Saturdays it would be busy, but Friday nights were
loading up for the weekend. Oh, absolutely. You were getting 3 or 4.
Absolutely, because the thing is it was, you know, you would get on the new releases you could get 2 days.
Yeah,
but on the regular ones you get 5 days. Yeah, like on the back catalog stuff. So this, I'll never forget this as long as I live. This couple comes in, and they come up and I'm talking like lines down the middle of the store. There's just me and Anthony was the other guy that he came in, you know, and it was just the two of us that are there, you know, on this Friday. And matter of fact, I'm staying over because I was supposed to have left, you know, but we were just so busy. It's like, I can't do that. You know, I'm not just going to take off.
Yeah.
Because there was someone else who was supposed to come in, but
flaked on you.
No, she was there, but it was faster for me to get this down to a something, you know, but while she was putting videos out or, you know, helping people or whatever, you know. So I'm on one register, Anthony's on the other, and we're going through, you know, we're trying to get people through as fast as possible and everything. So this couple comes up, and so I pull up their account. You know, they hand me their card, I scan it, you know, whatever. I pull up their account, and they've got a late fee,
yeah,
which is something that happens all the time, and that stuff would stay on there until somebody paid it off, you know. And it was also one of those things is like, until you pay it, you can't rent anything.
Yeah.
And so I'm like, hey, you guys have a late fee on here. And they both kind of had a puzzled look on their face, you know. And the woman was doing most of the talking here.
Yeah.
And she's like, why would there be a late fee? Because we haven't rented here in a while, you know, and this kind of stuff. I'm like, well, you've got something on here. And she's like, well, what is it? And I was like, I can't tell you. She's like, what do you mean you can't tell me? I was like, well, I don't have a title. She's like, why don't you have a title? I was like, because when you rent, when you would rent an adult video, it would just say adult video. It wouldn't have the title in it because a lot of times those titles were pretty vulgar, So they would just say adult video, you know? And I was like, because it was an adult video. Of course, there's people here everywhere. And she's like, what do you mean? There's an adult video rented on this. I'm like, yes, ma'am, there was an adult video. And I told her, you know, what the date was, you know, and said it was returned late, and, you know, so there's a fee on here. She's like, well, that can't be because, you know, we would never rent anything like that, you know, and just going on and on. And her husband's standing right there, and he's really, like, on this as well, you know, and even starting to, like,
yeah.
And I'm like, but, ma'am, I can't, you know, this is, I can't take this. I mean, that someone rented this on your account.
Yeah.
Well, it wasn't me, and I know it wasn't my husband, you know, and this and that, and blah, blah. She's like, when was it? When was it rented again? And I told her the date. She's like, see, I was out of town when that happened. I don't know how that could have gotten on there. And of course, in my head, I'm putting together, you were out of town, your husband was still in town, and he rented this thing on the account is what it is, you know. And I'm looking at him, and really and truly, the whole time I'm looking at him, I'm like, kind of giving the dude, if you'll just give me the head shake or something, you know, to like, I'll help you out here.
Yeah.
But he had doubled down on,
oh no,
this isn't happening, you know? And I was just like, well, I was like, she was like, who rented it? And I was like, well, it doesn't tell me who rents it here. She was like, you know, well, how was it paid for? I was like, well, you know, actually it was paid for by, one of our free, you know, our vouchers and the tenfold, you know, the 10 things. She's like, well, I don't know, it must have been somebody else using my account. I want that taken off there. And, you know, because there's no, I wouldn't do blah, blah, blah. I was like, you know what? Give me just a second.
You went back and pulled the record.
I went back and pulled, and I did. I went back there, and I'm like, all right, I know it's in this box, you know, so I'm going through blah, 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 blah.
Yep.
Pulled it out. It's got a signature on there
yeah.
and everything. And so I come walking back. I'm like, I'm sorry it took so long. She's like, well, I just don't understand this because this is blah, 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 blah.
Well, here's who signed for
and
your
I
movie.
And I said, do you recognize this signature? And she looks at it and immediately gives her husband a death stare. Followed by a string of, I am so sorry. We'll pay for this. We'll get this taken care of. I mean, just... And I'm just like, dude, if he had just given me the, don't you know but it was when he had doubled down on this didn't happen. I don't know, you know, and that's the whole thing. She was out of town.
Yeah,
he came in to rent something and got that thing. Oh well, hey, I can use this to get an adult video, and she'll never know. I have
your sins,
many stories.
Your sins always come back to find you.
I have so many stories. Well, that was a very brief synopsis of our first episode of 2020. From there, we moved on. We covered many movies over the course of this year.
We covered Fanboys and The King of Kong and Fight Club and Star Wars and Pump Up the Volume and, oh man, so many more, especially once we got into Oktoberfest. And then, of course, if you've been listening to us, you know that to round out the year, we ended with A Christmas Story, followed by a very unconventional Christmas in which we had another guest, our friend Barry, who came on to talk about the movies that are Christmas movies that are a little unconventional. Of course, Die Hard is always the one people go to. Of course, Gremlins and some other stuff like that. And right now, I want to give you a little clip from that one to give you a taste of what we did.
Okay. For those of you wondering, right now I have like a really nice microphone in front of me, and these two guys are using tin cans attached by a string.
Pretty much.
he's not far off.
Now we are sitting here, as we're recording this, we are less than a week away from Christmas.
Yes.
When this goes live, we're going to be even less than a week away from Christmas. Even closer. And Barry actually came to us with this topic. So, you know what, guys? I'm going to do something I never do.
Uh-oh.
I'm going to let you guys drive this thing.
Okay, who are you and what have you done with Alan?
I completely planned on you and Barry driving this thing and me sitting there being able to sit over here and engineer a little bit.
I did my research on this, don't get me wrong, but I am not as... I see this PDF that you have over here, sir. And it's...
Yeah, I did my homework. What can I say, guys?
Kind of like when I came in here on our Five Deep episode, and Dave was like, what in the world did you do? I'm like, yeah, that's...
All right, well, I guess I'll go ahead and explain.
Okay, hold on. We're going to talk about Christmas movies that aren't Christmas movies.
Unconventional Christmas movies, yes.
And of course, there's going to be some obvious ones on here, but I've got a couple that you may or may not have gotten. Oh. But I'm going to let you guys...
I got to peek at his list. His list may...
There's going to be a few that throw you a curveball.
That pretty much put us out of business, because I think he has both of our lists on his list.
Honestly.
Good. No, I will say, when I started doing a little research on this, and yes, I did my homework, I kind of looked at it, and you have to really ask yourself, is it a Christmas movie, or is it a movie that took place during Christmas?
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So I came up with three basic rules to kind of make sure that it is a Christmas movie. The first one, is Christmas used meaningfully in the storyline? Basically, does it play a pivotal role? Is there something about it that ties into it? The second one, could you possibly see this movie being made at any other point in time of year and it still be good?
Okay.
And the third one, and this one's pretty obvious, but, some of them struggle with this. Is the audience aware that the movie is taking place at Christmas?
Okay.
Basically, are there things in the atmosphere, in the backgrounds, that's telling it it's a Christmas movie?
Right.
And I will say some of these are going to start some arguments. I'm sure of it.
Sure. No problem.
Do you want to go ahead and start or you want me to start?
I'm letting you guys drive this one. So,
well, Dave, if you don't mind,
Welcome to the Barry Show.
Go ahead.
All right. Well, I'll start off with one of my all-time favorite Christmas movies.
Okay.
And I'm sure it's one that both of you two have seen from 1984.
Gremlins.
Gremlins.
Figured as much.
Absolutely.
Looks like something you're seeing porn or something.
Oh, no.
Wow.
He's already
got 13 minutes, yes.
Love it. All right. Well, that's my first one. What do you got?
I'm just going to go ahead and get mine right off the bat Dave can go ahead and get it out of his system.
No, hold on. Let me get the bucket. Go ahead.
It might not meet your criteria 100%, Eyes Wide Shut.
Now that
I got that out of the way, Dave, go ahead.
I'm going in a completely different direction. Yeah. I went with Batman Returns from 1992.
That's a good one.
Yes.
Well, as you can tell, we had a really good time with that episode. We were really happy to have Barry there with us, and you never know, you might see him again in this coming year. Go back, that was episode 70, our very last episode of 2020, and you can get our entire list of unconventional movies that are Christmas-themed. Now we can go on to, several times this year I tried to get Dave to actually like make a list and keep it to, let's say 10 items on the list. I would make my 10 item list and then Dave would, bring out 30 or 100,000 or something like that. So here's a snippet. And on this episode, we are going to be doing our, well, we started off as our 10 favorite 80s movies.
Alan did it to me again. I have trouble paring this stuff down. And it went from, well, it was supposed to be 10, and now I have like,
a bunch, yeah. It's several pages
I've
worth.
I've got 3 pages worth of stuff, yeah. And I didn't even put down everything that I really wanted to.
Even I said, oh, it won't be that bad. And Dave and I are both sitting here making our lists, like sitting in silence, and all of a sudden I'm like, oh, damn it, I forgot about that. Where am I going to put that? So we compromised, kind of. I said, okay, let's just do our top 15. So we're going to do our top 15 80s movies.
It got worse after that even because... Then it was like, okay, let's leave out the horror movies and we'll do our top 100 of horror.
Here's a spoiler or a preview for Oktoberfest. We're going to come back and do our best our favorite 80s horror movies.
I think we ought to just do horror movies and include the stuff that, you know, we love from the 70s too.
Or maybe we just narrow it down to our 80s horror movies and you have to actually make a list that's cohesive.
That's never going to happen.
Right, and this episode, you know, we've done a couple episodes in the past, which are like, you know, our favorite songs from the 80s or our favorite movies from the 80s or favorite horror movies from the 80s. Well, we're going to jump ahead a decade and go into the 90s now and talk about our favorite comedy movies of the 1990s. I am willing to bet good money that Dave does not stay inside of the 90s.
I did.
You did?
I did.
Okay, we'll see. Because we will fact check.
I'm 80% sure I did.
80%. All of a sudden, yeah, we see that percentage go down as it goes on. So
it's kind of like the election.
Yeah, something like that. Oh, I see Dave's the one that's going to go ahead and like get political now. So.
See what you did to me?
I didn't do anything. I did not do anything. So anyways, yeah, we're going to talk about our favorite comedy, our movies from the 1990s. You want to start or do you want me to start?
I'll start. And okay.
Just out of curiosity, how many movies do you have on here?
I listed 20, but we go as far as you want to go.
And I have 12.
We'll do your list.
And I guarantee we're going to have some of the same ones on here. So
maybe.
Yeah. And so we kind of said, hey, let's put together the soundtracks of our lives. Like, you know, I'll do one for my life. Dave does one for his life.
Yep.
We sat down and we started doing this stuff. And
I had a problem.
Yeah. And I was going to get to that because I generally I am the one that will sit down and be like, oh, I've got 85 songs on this thing, you know, and I didn't this time. I actually got a very like, no, this would be here. This would be here. This would be here. This. Okay. Yeah. Blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, I think I'm still under 25 songs. And that's on my first pass.
Yeah.
And Dave comes to me today and says,
my first pass was somewhere around 50. And then I tried to weed out songs and somehow it became 70. And I'm
getting text messages from him today, and it's like, I went to weed out songs, and now I'm up to 175. I'm like, what?
No, it was 100. It was 145.
Okay,
And then we went to dinner, and it went from 145 to more like 170.
Yeah, and I added like 3 more to mine. So.
And that's just what's on paper. What the list in my head is actually closer to like 350.
Yeah,
growing.
Well, it's always fun giving Dave a hard time, but I think I'm going to end this episode with a story that I told on our episode about the ones that got away, and you can see how much of an idiot I was when I was younger, and Dave does not let me off the hook on this one, and nor should he have, so enjoy, and I'll be back with some final thoughts before we close out this show. There was this girl that was in there, okay?
Yeah.
This is what I can tell you about her, okay? Her name was Tara.
Okay.
Her last name started with, I cannot remember her last name, I do know this. Her last name started with an M.
Mm-hmm.
It was about 15 letters long and had a lot of consonants in it.
Okay.
You know, obviously some Polish type name, or you know, Russian. Or something like that, you know. But no, but she was fully American. I mean, she was 100% American, but somewhere down the line, her family had come from that, you know, the Eastern Bloc somewhere, you know. Over the course of the semester, you talked to her quite a bit and got pretty friendly with her, you know, just in class. And I noticed that she was kind of
gravitating towards me a little bit, you know.
Yeah.
And the thing is that she was blonde hair, blue eyes, thin, big boobs, you know. I mean, like, what you would kind of, I mean, she very much had what was model-esque in a lot of ways, but she was really cool, like very down to earth, very approachable, very, you know, yeah, that type of stuff. And she worked at a restaurant, like I found out, you know, and I went and ate there a couple of times. My dad and I went and ate there one night, and she was our server, you know, and it was one of those things. He even asked me about her. Like, so how do you know her? He's like, oh, we got a class together, you know? And he's like, And he was noticing how, you know, and that kind of stuff. Of course, I was still with the person that I was with at the time, even though everything's falling apart. You know,
yeah.
So over the course of from late August when we started there until late November sometime, okay? And this is, and by the time late November rolled around, my relationship had ended, you know, and that kind of stuff. And it was funny because my friend that was in the class, that not Benji, but this other girl that I had known for a while, who we had classes together, plus the fact we had mutual friends and had known each other for a while, I think she had kind of been observing what was going on, and she even asked me about my, you know, girlfriend. Yeah. And I told her, you know, I was like, no, we're not, you know, that's been on the rocks for a while and we're not together any longer, you know, and that kind of stuff, you know. But it was kind of one of those, I know she was fishing into what's going on here. So anyways, I say all of that to say this. If she did it once, she did it a dozen times over that 3-month period of gave me her telephone number and said, hey, you should call me and we'll get together and hang out. You know, she was one of those things. She was about a year older than me, and she had moved back here from California.
Sure.
Had an apartment, all that kind of stuff. And she was always like, yeah, you should, you know, give me a call and we should, you know, we'll get together and, you know, come over to the apartment, you know, we can study or this or that or whatever, you know, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
Never called her. Then one day, she was just gone. Close to the end of the semester. Like, I didn't even finish out. Like, she dropped out.
Yeah.
Gone. Of course, I couldn't find her number anywhere. She had written, I remember very specifically her writing it down on several, and couldn't find any of that kind of stuff. Okay. So, of course, I'm kind of, especially now, you know, the semester ends, you get through the holidays, all that kind of stuff. And I'm like, man, I wish I had her phone number. I wish. So fast forward a couple months. I'm at the Great Escape here in Madison. Okay. I'm in there and I'm looking at them. I'm over, you know, they use music, you know, CDs and all that kind of stuff. I'm flipping through, blah, 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 blah. Flipping through, look down. Tara standing there. Huh. So I walk around, I'm like, hey. And she turned around, looked at me, and just like, eyes got huge, you know. She's all like, oh my God, you know, how, you know, and gave me this big hug, you know, and we got to talking. She's like, yeah, you know. And I was like, what happened? You know, you just kind of like disappeared one day, you know. And she's like, yeah, you know, some stuff was going on, and you know, I've kind of been dealing with some family stuff and this and that. And she's like, I'm pretty sure that I'm gonna, or she's like, I'm moving back to California, you know, just kind of, I miss it out there, you know. I had built a life there and that kind of stuff, and I kind of miss it and all that kind of stuff. And I was like, oh, well, that's a shame, you know. It was everything, and she was like, yeah, I know. And so we talked for like half an hour or something, and we're both shopping, like, you know, have you listened? Oh yeah, that's a good CD. What about this? You know, you're listening to, blah, blah, blah. Go up to the counter and checking out and all that kind of stuff, and she was in front of me, and she checked out, and she's like, you know, I'm really glad I ran into you, because, you know, she's like, and she goes, I've thought about you a lot, you know, from that, you know, because, you know, you were somebody I really enjoyed talking to, you know, like, kind of stuff, blah, blah, blah. And it's like, yeah, it's a shame that you're moving back to California, you know. And she's like, you know, I'm not moving for another month.
If you tell me you didn't call her.
She gave me her phone number. She's like, call me. We'll get together and hang out before I go back to California. I never called her.
Oh.
I know. And again, it's been 25 years since that happened, okay? And I have thought about her so many times in that time period.
You're such a moron.
And that, believe me, that sentiment right there has gone through my head so many times. Moron.
As a good friend, let me just go ahead and vocalize this. You are a stupid idiot. You get one last chance.
And still didn't.
And
I know. I especially when I was that age, admittedly, I'm not the brightest star in the sky now, but when I was that age, I was really, really inept and just an idiot. So
I don't know if it was just that I was desperate, but if a girl gave me her number, I was calling and it,
I am not joking. This girl was smoking hot. It was one of those things that, if she walked in the room, everybody turned around and looked at her.
Have you tried stalking her on Facebook?
I can't remember what her last name is. Believe me, way back in the MySpace days, I'm like, how did she spell her? What was it? Because I'm serious. There was a ton of consonants. And I just remember it was Tara M. And that was it. So, good. So, yeah, I know. But, hey, who knows?
I'm embarrassed for you.
Yeah, that was not my finest.
You've had a lot of.
I've had a lot, but that one's near the top of. As I have said many times, if I could go, if I were in the same room with the 20-year-old me, it would just be a not just for that, but there would be a constant like, you're going to be lucky to get out of this room alive, kid. Well, this is a little shorter episode than what we normally do, but I'll be honest, it was. It's kind of difficult to be able to take a year's worth of podcasts and kind of boil them all down into one singular episode without going for a couple of hours. Plus, one of the things that I've learned in doing this is that if we're going to do a clip episode at the end of the year, we should probably start in January when the year starts and just kind of pull the clips out along the way and put them in to a file. Especially since it's just me working on this, but that's fine. I had fun putting this together. We had a great year with the Project GenX Podcast. For those of you who don't know, we actually rebranded this year. We originally were the Project X Podcast. There were already a few of those out there, and we felt like the Project GenX Podcast was a better name for our show, mainly because we cover so much stuff dealing with Generation X, and with Dave and I both being of that generation, it just made sense. So, here we are at the end of the year. We did 49 episodes total. There were a couple of lags early on. We should have had more than that. And this next year, hopefully 2021 will be a better year all around than 2020 was. And we will get out more episodes for you, and you will continue to enjoy what we're doing. So for Dave and I both, I would like to say thank you. All of our episodes are in the back catalog. You can go back and hear those with no problems. And we thank you for listening in 2020, and we hope that you will continue in 2021 because we're going to keep making these. So for the Project GenX Podcast, I would like to say thank you very much, and we will see you in because it's like, especially growing up here in Nashville, you see people who are good, and then you see people who are like excellent.
See, here's the thing about living in Nashville is that everybody's
good. Everybody's good.
Whether you play guitar or not, you know how to tune one.
Exactly.
And everybody knows three chords in this town.
Right.
Everybody.
Right.
Which absolutely drives one of my coworkers crazy because he bought a guitar and was trying to learn it, and he was just sitting in his office. He was so mad because everybody that came in would pick it up and start strumming something on it. He couldn't figure out how to play
it. It's like, well, yeah, that's kind of living in Nashville.
But there's a bar in Nashville that everybody plays guitar. That's not that's not a rumor. It's not a joke.
No, it's not. Everyone plays guitar.
Even the drummers in this town play guitar.
It's true.
Three chords and get through, two or three songs.
Right. because I'm just going to beat you repeatedly.
See, if I had known this was going on, if I had been with you, I would have looked at her and said, give me the number because he's going to lose it.
It wasn't that I lost it so much.
You lost
like,
it.
No, I
You'd
didn't.
You leave it in your jeans. Your mom would wash it.
One time, there was this one. I was on the way up there. It was a early afternoon class, like right after lunch, you know. And I was driving past Krispy Kreme, and the light was on. So I was like, "Hey, it's not a big class." So I went and bought a dozen donuts, you know, or whatever, because there was less than a dozen of us in there at that point, because a few people had dropped out, you know. Hey, no big deal. I'm taking it. Get there. The teacher wasn't there. She had something come up, so she had to cancel class.
Yeah.
Well, there's me and her and like two other people or something, you know. I'm like, I brought donuts, you know. And so we kind of sat around and talked for a little while. Everybody else kind of left, and it was just her and I for a while, you know. And we were talking. We were standing in the parking lot talking or whatever, and she was like, I got to go. I got to work tonight. I'm like, yeah, I know. I was like, I've got another class coming up and blah, blah, blah. She reaches into her purse and pulls out a pen and writes on the top of the donut box her name and phone number. And she was like, call me sometimes and we will get together and hang out.
Blockhead.
And here's the thing. I tell that story, and now, like all these years later, I kind of start thinking of it from her vantage point of, you know, she's got to be going, what is this moron? Like, why won't he call me?
Well, she got it right in the moron part.
I know. So it's, but again, I've thought about her a lot over the years.
Yeah.
And this, that falls perfectly into the ones that got away.
Yeah.
Okay.
Actually, you didn't let that one get away. You just kept that one back in the lake.
Yeah, I know. That was, no, that one, I didn't even catch that one. That one kept jumping in my boat, and I kept knocking it back out.
You're not supposed to jump in the boat. You got to get the hook.
I didn't catch you. Get back in the lake. It's idiot.
Sometimes I wonder.
I know. Okay. I have one more. And I'm not.
Could it be as painful as that one? Is it as painful as that one?
Yeah. Because
why do I bother to ask?
Because I'm not going to say her name.
Okay.
For a lot of reasons. There was someone that was in my life for a long period of time.
Yeah.
That I really developed feelings for. We were friends. That was, you know.
Yeah.
There was never anything more than that. We were friends. And it was one of those things that a lot of it, some of it was timing. Some of it was that I've not been someone who got involved with friends over the years.
Yeah.
Because I was friends with them for a reason.
Yeah.
Not that there wasn't an attraction, not that there wasn't more than an attraction there, but it was more of a, I don't want to come out the other end of this and not have them as a friend any longer.
Sure.
You know? And, of course, you know, some people are like, well, if they're your friend, then, you know, it shouldn't be a big deal. No. Because it's like, no. I have seen plenty of friendships
changes
ruined.
Changes the dynamic.
Absolutely. And this person was someone that I said, because I'm not saying her name, but I know that I'm probably going to give a lot away here when I say this. I have always maintained, I told her even one time that she was one of my favorite people that I've ever met. And she still is one of my favorite people I've ever met, even though, you know, we're not in contact any longer, at least not in real contact anymore. You know, Facebook, you're in contact with everybody, you know, in some way. But it was just one of those situations where I never could get the timing right.
Yeah.
There was one time where thought the timing was going to be right, and it wasn't.
Yeah.
The biggest regret I have out of all that is not that nothing ever happened or that I never really pursued her. It was a very unfortunate situation that came later. Dealing with social media and dealing with my alcoholism, the drunken message, you know.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, it wasn't anything, you know, it was basically me pouring my heart out. And it was...
The drunk, I love you.
Yes. And it was, oh, man, it was one of those things that at the time I was so like, I can't, I'm... Finally, you know, after all these years, and waking up the next morning and being like, oh, please, can I unsend that? Please, can I unsend that?
Nope.
And you can't. And it was one of those things that it was a full day before she got back to me because
that,
she hadn't gotten, you know, and I was like,
she's thinking about it.
And I was seriously like, should I send a message with, like, hey, like, read this first of like, please just delete that message and don't. You know, but
if you send that message,
I know, and then it's, I know
they go and they read it anyway.
And so there was the when she finally did get back in touch with me, it was the, you know, there's so much going on in my life right now, and I know there's a lot going on in your life, and you know, blah 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 blah. And it was a really nice no, okay, which was, you know. It probably deserved a much sterner than, you know,
yeah.
Because it wasn't anything like, you know, that was, but, you know, just drunken ramblings, you know, type stuff.
Yes.
But I do remember very distinctly after all that, like maybe an hour later, getting another message from her. And all it said was, I wish you had said something years ago. I mean, like.
That hurts.
I know.
That hurts.
And it was one of those things that I was like. Okay, and I got in touch with her a couple days later. I was like, look, I want to apologize again,
yeah.
You know, and I was like, I would really like to get together and talk, not about that. I would just like to talk to you in general,
yeah.
and apologize in person and all that kind of stuff, you know. I'm not, it's fine, you know, that's, I want you to know that this is,
I got it even off my chest.
I got it off my chest. Yeah. What I said was true, but
I don't have this bottled up anymore.
Exactly, and it's fine. And, yeah. And what you said was right, but I would still like to be able to apologize in person and let's talk about it and kind of get over with. And it just never worked out that we did.
Sure.
You know, but the great thing is that, you know, she has a beautiful family now. Mm-hmm. You know, and a husband and a kid and all that kind of stuff. And I see and I'm like, I am so happy for her. And I'm happy to still have her at least somewhat in my life.
Sure.
Nothing like it was before, you know, even in the friendship because she's miles and miles away and all that kind of stuff. And also the fact that, like, you know, I'll be honest, I don't feel like that's been a while back, you know, but it's also one of those things and you go on and that kind of stuff. It's like, all right, fine. I really wish we had gotten the opportunity to talk about it,
sure,
you know, yeah. Just as a, but at the same time, I'm like, no, it's fine because we're adults. And, but she is someone that, again, I have thought about a lot over the years of doing the, well, what if at this point, or at this point, you know, type stuff, how different now. Looking back on my life, I also look at that and go, I was a mess through all of those points.
Yep.
And so we would have no relationship now whatsoever because I know I would have screwed it up because I was a drunken mess for years and years and years and years, and she did not deserve to have to put up with that.
Yeah.
You know, so she will always be one of my favorite people.
Absolutely.
So that one, you know, not quite as entertaining as my previous story of buffoonery, but
yeah.
So yeah, it just like I said, not as entertaining as the other story, but one that when I started putting when I first came up with this idea of things are the ones that got away.
Yeah.
She was the first. One that came to mind.
I get that.
So,
and it's not that I didn't have
Oh, yeah. I know. You're in a much different place. You are happily married. There's no use in dredging up all that stuff.
Well, and,
you know, and
there's a couple that I'm also still not ready to rip the scab off
of. And there's that, also. I mean, and that's a... Yeah, you know, yeah. I can... The Tara story,
yeah.
I can tell that story and laugh about it now. I've told that story many times over the years of to different people, and they all that exact same idiot. What in the you know? But this story, really and truly, there's only one other person that has ever heard outside of her. There's only one other person who's ever heard as much of the story as I just told.
Sure.
So this was kind of a it's time. To get this out as a, okay, I did.
You did this.
I did this.
And let it go.
Exactly. You know, and.
No, and so, I am happily married.
Right.
But even if you're happily married, there are always those what ifs. Mm-hmm. You know, there, you're always going to have those couple, you know.
Right.
You know, what ifs. Right. And I've got a couple of those. I just don't want to talk about it.
I understand that. I mean, it's, I understand that completely. I could probably put. One or two more on this of one in particular that, you know, of someone who I actually was involved with that, and I really do not want to get into that story because even though that's been a long time, that's still one that gets me riled up.
I know exactly who I'm talking about.
Yeah. So it's,
That one actually gets me a little riled up. I
know. Well, you know, it's funny. That one gets pretty much all of my friends riled up whenever her name you know, surfaces. So
she who must not be named.
Yeah, it is. It's a. It. There's been many times over the years that I have spoken her name, and then all of a sudden she appears from nowhere.
She's almost like Beetlejuice.
It is.
Really.
It's that. Well, it's that whole, you know, speak of the devil, and the devil appears. You know, and it's kind of that. So we don't talk about her. So.
Yep.
And that's a long story, so.
Yeah, that might be like a four-parter.
Well, I really don't want to get into that one, because that is
let's leave that one alone.
But anyways, that was the ones that got away. Some happy stories, some not.
Yeah.
And, but a lot of what-ifs. We all have them. Like I said, regrets, I have a few.
Find out who got my shotgun. I'm coming for you.
Dave's got a list, so it's...
I named number one and number three tonight.
There you go. You never say anything about number two, huh? Mm-mm. Not going to. All right, so...
All right. Well, I'm Big Dave.
So, if you would like to get in touch with us...
Oh, yeah, we got to do this. If you want to get a hold of us, we've got this stuff right here. All right, hey guys, we want to thank you for listening and supporting us all this time. Just wanted to let you know we can be found on Apple Podcast at Project X Pod. We're also on Google Play. We're on Stitcher. We're on Tuned In Radio. And hopefully we're going to be getting on some other platforms also. You can also get a hold of us by email at projectxpod@gmail.com. I've also got my own private one at bigdavexpod@gmail.com. We're on Twitter at Project XPod, and there's also at Big Dave XPod. We're on Facebook at Project X Podcast, and we're on YouTube. We're starting to do some stuff on YouTube at Project X Podcast. So if you like us, please spread the word. You know, let your friends know. If you can't stand us, tell all your enemies. You know, you can torture them that way. Thanks, guys. We appreciate it.
All right, that's enough. Let's get on with the show.
All right, bye.
And now that you know how to get in touch with us, please do tell us. You don't have to go into quite the details that
we don't hear
something else. Something else. Not even that. If you like the show, subscribe wherever that you get your podcast. You know, whether it's Apple. Apple helps quite a bit because you know and post a review if you don't mind because that helps quite a bit.
That will actually get us up in the ratings and get us
more listeners exactly and that type of stuff. Also, anytime you can. Obviously, we just told you, but yeah, really, you know.
Please contact us.
projectxpod@gmail.com. Believe me.
Talk to us, folks.
The people who have got in touch with us, we've gotten back to.
Yeah.
Very quickly. Anything. And if you have suggestions for, you know, I mean, we're always coming up with new topics here, but if there's anything you just want to hear about, I know a friend of ours got in touch with me the other night and was like, hey, man, why don't you guys talk about this? And I was like, that might actually be a decent something to talk about.
Sure.
I'm not going to say what it is because it's probably going to wind up being
Well, my wife is always handing me
Yeah,
ideas.
I know. And that's, and of course, Corey, who was on with us, you know, yep. he's always like, hey, why don't you? And you were like, yeah, that's my mind. We'll probably have him back on at some point.
Yep.
But yeah, that's.
And I've got some ideas for other, know, yeah. for bringing people in and just talking to them.
But we've also had ideas for other, you know, growing this into a network more than just the one podcast.
Yeah.
And so there you go. We could have different shows about different topics.
Yeah.
So yeah. Anyways, guys, thank you so much for spending an hour and some change with us this time around. I am Alan Smith.
I am Big Dave.
And have a good week. did not think of him as a leading man. And the thing is that his agents, he got paid $5 million on that.
Yep.
And they were like, there's no way. All he's done is you know, moonlighting and a few little things here and there.
Yep.
But his people kept saying, no, Bruce Willis is a star. You just don't know it yet.
Yep.
And then he proved that he wasn't when he made Hudson Hawk.
Hey, be nice.
Hudson Hawk is not a bad movie, okay?
Oh, I'm got a barrel of money.
Would you like to swing on a star?
I did that just because I knew it'd get a rise out of both of them.
Oh, my gosh. The thing with Hudson Hawk, let's be honest, Bruce Willis has done far worse movies.
Oh, yeah.
But
The Color of Night.
I think, yeah. Mm-hmm. Hudson Hawk is one of those movies that I really believe got a bad rap off the bat. I mean, people were like, what is this, you know? And it's one of those things that, like, over time, it's kind of gains, people look at it and go, no, this is a good movie.
It's like UHF.
Yes.
When it first came out, it just got swallowed.
I love that movie.
But I know.
You also got to think about what UHF came out against.
True. Oh,
it came out against Batman and
Lethal Weapon. Honey, I Shrunk the Kids.
3 and, or was it? It was Lethal Weapon 2 that it came out against. Yep. It came out against Honey, I Shrunk the Kids. It came out against Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. Yep. I mean, it's one of those things
it
that,
got
like,
swallowed.
1989, that summer, is considered one of the biggest blockbuster movie, like the blockbuster summers of all time. And UHF came out right in the middle of
one
it.
One of my favorite lines that Weird Al ever said about that movie. He did it in an interview when it was released, and he said, "It's kind of like Purple Rain, but it's intentionally funny."
Yes. Which, we love Prince here,
yes,
but that movie's terrible.
Oh my God,
I mean, come on. It's,
I posted a meme on my Facebook not too long ago where someone had made a Prince Christmas tree that was purple and
yes,
white.
Yes, I know,
and said,
I know.
This is what happens when you water your Christmas tree with the water from the Lake Minnetonka.
You saw the gift that I left
yes.
for you, though.
So, yeah, this is... you know, it's funny. We've talked about this before. Christmas is one of those holidays that I've always kind of had like a very contemptuous relationship with.
Yeah.
Until I had kids, and then all of a sudden I'm like, oh, actually, it was until I got sober, and then I had kids a few years later, and it's like
I'm
combination.
Glad you got those in the right order. By
exactly.
The way.
Yeah. And believe me, I am too. So it's one of those things that the two things happen, and it's funny because I got sober in early November,
mm-hmm.
and my son was born right before Christmas. So it's one of those things that, like, this time of year,
surprise!
Yeah, not the same year, but it was, you know, it was a couple years later, but it was still one of those things where it was like,
right.
I always tell people that too. Whenever they're like, oh, when's his birthday, and I tell them, like, yeah, obviously we weren't planning, we had intended to get pregnant, but we weren't really planning it out of when this was going to fall, you know? So it was
I should have bought you a calendar. Anyway,
well, that's one of those things. Anytime you see somebody that's born in November, that means that they're a Valentine's baby.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, I was born in July, which means it was a cold Christmas.
Yes, exactly. Hey, I just saw a thing today where there's been like a huge increase in babies born in the last like 2 weeks.
Yeah, like who wasn't going to predict
Yeah, I know.
That?
It's like, kidding. Yep, they're all COVID babies. So it's
yeah, we're gonna have a second baby boom.
I know.
It's all going to be the coronials.
Yeah, the coronials.
Oh, my God. Who's your writer? I want to know. Who is your writer?
As Ellen knows, I write all my own stuff,
oh
which is why
gosh.
It's terrible.
And he does his own stunts, too, folks.
Yeah, he does. It's unfortunately. All right, guys. Thank you so much for spending some time with us for this unconventional Christmas episode. We will be back. There is one more episode between now and the end of the year. It is going to be a clip show, which means I'm going to be working on this thing for the next week and a half to get it out.
Merry Christmas to
yeah,
you.
Yeah, I know. Merry Christmas. Well, it actually works out pretty well now that, you know, kids out of school and all that kind of stuff. And yep. I finally, as we're sitting here, we are 6 days from Christmas as we're recording this, mm-hmm. okay? I started my Christmas shopping last night.
I'm actually proud of myself. I knocked two of the Christmas presents for Miss Nay off the list already.
Oh, yeah. Nice.
See, and I'm just the opposite. I'm one of those people that when I get it, I've got to get it wrapped. I've got to get another
oh, really?
Tree. I can't let it sit. So my girlfriend and I, Amy. Hi, Amy.
Yeah.
We
need to get her on here.
Yeah. She almost came today.
Hey, that would have been good. Hey, we would have set her up with
oh,
a microphone.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Like, come on, get in here. So it's...
Yeah.
I had one more mic with
Yeah, so it's...
So we spent, I think we're up until like 12 or 1 o'clock in the morning wrapping Christmas presents last night. And just between the put on Casey Kasem on iHeartRadio and just let it run. And I mean,
well, they've got old Casey Kasem stuff.
Yeah,
really?
They have an entire channel of nothing but the old American Top 40s.
That's awesome.
Yes. Wow. And we just let that play, and we're wrapping presents to the point of exhaustion. So it was a great, it's a great way to spend an evening.
One of my, I'm not, another thing, I'm really not a big fan of Christmas music, per se.
Depends.
Now, there are some, you know, like I usually like our unconventional Christmas stuff. True. You know, like a Father Christmas by the Kinks, and, you know,
Fairy Tale of New York.
Yes, you know, that type of Oi to the World. Mm-hmm. You know, it's stuff like that. Like, okay, I can get behind this stuff. You know, Weird Al's
The Night Santa Went Crazy is one of my favorites.
Or Christmas at Ground Zero, yes, which I'm probably going to use for the intro and outro on this.
Nice.
The Ramones,
oh, Merry Christmas, I don't want to fight tonight. Yeah, that kind of, like, I like that type of stuff as opposed to, like, the traditional, even like traditional, like, you know, Blue Christmas or any of that kind of stuff, you know, I'm like,
right.
But I will say this. And as I've gotten older, I've always loved Chris Isaak. Okay. Love Chris Isaak.
True.
His Christmas album is spectacular because it's got that Southern California whatever, but it's still Christmas enough.
Right.
To where it's like, no, when I decorate the Christmas tree, this is what I'm listening to. So that's...
Here's what's weird is I'm exactly the opposite. I've got a Pandora station that I've been basically building for a decade at this point.
Just Christmas songs?
That's just... I started with the Christmas song.
Okay.
With Bing Crosby.
Oh, I was going to say Nat King Cole, but okay.
With Bing Crosby. Yeah. And I've basically been building it from there, but it's all that old... You know, Frank Sinatra and Bing Crosby, right, and Nat King Cole,
Burl Ives,
all of that old, because that's what I grew up with. Mom,
yeah, right. Oh, yeah, yeah.
We had a record player in the house, and mom had, I think, four or five record players, and a lot of them were from where the gas stations would have, you know, you'd be able to get a Christmas record from the gas station when you filled up.
Here's your classic movie trivia here.
Oh, goodness.
I'm in trouble already.
What movie?
Tag, baby, I got you.
What movie introduced the song White Christmas?
Holiday Inn.
Yes.
Yep.
Most people think it's White Christmas. It's like, no, it was Holiday Inn.
No, it's Holiday Inn.
Yeah, and I love that.
You ain't going to get me on a Danny Kaye joke, man. Come on now.
Those two movies are actually two that I like to watch during Christmas.
I do too.
Oh, yeah.
I'm a black and white Miracle on 34th Street guy. Okay. It's a Wonderful Life guy.
Right.
And then I always have to watch National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation.
Of course. Of course.
And my favorite meme this year that I've seen was a picture of course, Cousin Eddie out there emptying his chemical toilet into the, and it says, Twitter's full.
And see, my favorite. That's good. That is really good, I have to admit.
I wish I had been the one to come up with it. And in fact, I had to go, I work for a local college, and I had to go to our South Campus the other day, and over... you know, where they put the safety messages over the interstate.
Right, right.
It says, Cousin Eddie says Twitter's full, put the phone down and drive.
Yeah, that's awesome.
That is one of the more, I will say that that's become iconic. That is truly hit iconic.
I've always
status.
Loved that movie. I'll be honest, and I know this is a little bit blasphemous when I say this, that's the only one of the vacation movies I care anything about.
I still love the original.
See, I never liked the original that much. I liked it well enough, and I really never liked European Vacation.
No.
Don't even get me started on Vegas Vacation, because that was just a...
Well, let's be honest.
That was a money grab.
It was.
Chevy Chase is an abominable individual.
Oh, yeah.
He's just not a nice person. But for some reason, in that movie, he actually comes across as likable.
I think Bill Murray had the greatest... line about him ever, because apparently after, you know, Chevy,
they almost got into a fist fight.
That was the whole thing during that when Chevy Chase came back to SNL after he left, because he was only there for a year, and he left and came back to host, and him and Bill Murray got into it backstage, and as they're pulling, and that was the whole that they almost
was it
got,
there or was it on the set of Caddyshack?
No, it was that one.
Yeah,
okay. I think Caddyshack, there was some of it with that, because that was later.
Yeah,
okay, but it was literally one of those things where they had to pull them apart backstage. And as Bill Murray's walking away, he goes, medium talent.
Wow.
Yep. When it comes down to the Chevy Chase or Bill Murray argument,
Bill Murray every time. Yeah. Well, you know the whole thing. We are so far off. You know the whole thing about the, you know, when Comedy Central did the roast.
Yes.
Have you heard the story? Oh. You heard the story about this, Dave? You heard
I
it?
Don't believe they I did. Have.
It was in 2004, 2005. Somewhere it was one of the first like roasts that they did.
Sure.
First off, no one from SNL would participate. Mm-mm. They couldn't get anybody to come in. It was the roast of Chevy Chase. Okay. Yeah. When it was, it only aired one time. Yeah, like, yeah, you know how they run those things to death.
Oh, yeah.
It only aired one time.
It was a train wreck.
It was a train wreck. And apparently, after it was over, Chevy Chase left and went back to his hotel room and cried the whole rest of the night at how people hated him so much.
Yeah.
I mean, just like...
Well, he kind of did it to himself.
He did it to himself. Well, and the thing is, he hasn't changed any, because we've all heard about what happened on Community. Him and Dan Harmon and all that kind of stuff. I mean, I'll say it.
It's been said before. Cocaine's a hell of a drug.
Yeah. You know? Yes, it is.
It does a lot of things to a lot of people. Yeah. And, you know...
By the way, if people ask me what I do, and I basically tell them, I said, you know the show The IT Crowd?
Mm-hmm. There you go.
You know the movie or the show Community?
Yes.
Okay, take those two and combine them, and that's my life every day.
So are you Richmond in the server room, you know, dressed in goth and all this stuff?
No.
Not anymore.
One of my favorite memes that's come out has the picture from The IT Crowd of him as Richmond hovering over Moss.
Yeah.
And it says on one side, Noel Fielding, and on the other side is people just trying to bake.
yes, it's true.
Well, gentlemen, I want to say thank you.
Yeah,
for
I know. Yeah,
here.
I know. We've kind of beat this horse to death,
I think you need to come back.
Yeah, exactly. You know, I know we've been talking about expanding our podcast network, and Barry and I have been working on doing something
ideas.
For a
we
while.
Had a few ideas.
Also the thing with Podbean, which is who we use, just updated.
Are we 2.0 compliant now?
Well, it's one of those things that they just did a bunch of updates to where we can manage multiple accounts podcasts from one account. And so I'm like, okay, good, because that was the whole thing before. It was like I was going to have to make an account for each one of them. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, so I'm like, I can just go in and do them all from this one spot. So
hopefully they'll upgrade to the new podcasting 2.0. So that way,
Adam Curry,
Podfather, that way we can start putting chapters and all that, and you can go in and clip us up.
You have to listen to the Jonathan Colton song, A Pod Safe Christmas Song.
Okay.
Because it makes mention to Adam Curry.
Oh, yeah?
It's basically the takeoff of the Chipmunks song.
Oh, really?
It is priceless.
Okay.
Yes, well, Christmas songs are for another episode.
That's a whole... You know, we did one last year. So.
Yeah, we did.
All right, guys, thank you so much for joining us. You can get in touch with us all of our social media. It's in the show notes.
Show notes.
We're basically Project X Pod at everything except for Parler, which doesn't have the pod. It's just Project Gen X.
What are you doing over there?
I have kind of started like staying away from over there quite a bit. So.
you kind of let your mind slip a little bit over there.
Well, you know, it is what it's 2020. So
you just slept yesterday.
Yeah, something like that. So, but yeah, guys, thank you so much, Barry. Thank you for coming back.
Thanks for having me.
We love
for
you,
being
bud.
Here.
Absolutely,
we absolutely love you, and you're welcome back here anytime.
We appreciate it.
And definitely next time we get Amy in here.
Oh yeah. Then the gloves are off.
we may have a breakup live on mic.
Remind me to get that 7-second button installed before she gets here.
You do have Kevlar, right? I may need it.
Just kidding, sweetie. We can separate you guys. We got plenty of room in here. So
that is Ellen Smith.
And that is Big Dave. And we're joined by
Barry Webb.
There we go. Where can people find you?
Currently, wherever I'm at.
That is the best answer I think we could ever go out on. So guys, thank you so very much, and we will see you next time.
See ya.